Hi there, my name is Lee Serena and welcome to Secrets of the Toaster System. In this tape we're going to be taking you into sort of the hidden world of the toaster, showing you things from basic functions such as deleting and renaming files using the Amiga's operating system, to some hidden files you might not have known about, to some things like running AREX programs in Toaster Paint, creating your own keyboard shortcuts in Toaster Paint, and finally ending up in Lightwave and Modeler, showing you how to customize Lightwave for your own needs, and also some secret macros that are hidden in Modeler. Now, we're really sort of traveling the entire length and breadth of the toaster here. We've got a lot to cover, so really let's get started right away. All right, so the first thing we want to talk about is the Amiga itself. And this throws a lot of people off. They sort of worry about the Amiga operating system, and you're going to see it's quite staggeringly easy to use. So first thing we need to do is get there from the toaster switcher screen. So from the switcher, the quick way to get to the Amiga, and again, this is from the switcher screen, only is hitting the control key, then the alt key. And you hit the control key twice, then the alt key twice. So it's control, control, alt, alt. And you notice that's on the left-hand side of the keyboard. It will also bring me back to this side here. So let's just head out. Sometimes if it doesn't take, just do it again. And then it will take. Okay. So here we are in the Amiga screen, and basically, the Amiga, much like the IBM PC, for instance, has two different sort of operating systems it uses, two different DOSes. And what's a DOS? DOS is disk operating system. And the disk operating system is just basically the program that lets you manage your files, renaming them, copying them, deleting them, that sort of thing. And on the IBM PC, for instance, you have DOS and Windows. Well, you have a similar thing on the Amiga, except in a lot of ways, I think, a little better and easier to use. On the Amiga, you've got two things. You've got the workbench, which is your graphic user interface, and you've got command line interface, where you use Amiga DOS, and Amiga DOS is just where you can type in commands. So let's just take a real quick look at Amiga DOS for 1 second. The way we would get there is we would go and just open up the drawer that has a shell window in it or CLI window. The icon will look the same. Double-click to open it up, and now we can type in commands. And again, any deleting, copying, stuff like that we want to do, we can do. So if we want to go to the toaster directory, we type in commands. This is like you'd see on a PC. CD toaster. And I'm putting a slash. And that tells it to go to a drawer called toaster. And then I could find out what file's under here by typing DIR. And pull this down so we can just see a little more of the stuff up top. And there's a drawer in here called, for instance, AREX examples. So I can go to it by typing CD, AREX, examples. You're getting the idea here, fun typing, and pretty much very, very soon it's called Dr. Kevorkian time. There's no possible way we're going to go on with this very long. It's no fun. It's a lot of work. And I could show you a lot of cryptic commands. If you've used DOS before on the PC, you'll see DIR, CD, all those commands are very familiar to you. Forget about it. We're not going to show you very much here, because frankly, everything you want to be able to do, you can do just by pressing and clicking a mouse. So here's a big command you need to see. It's NCLI, which gets us out of here. And actually, by the way, you don't even need this, because just click on the close button and you're gone. So let's talk about using the workbench to do a lot of this stuff. The workbench is a much easier way, and one of the big secrets is the fact that there's a lot of files that you're not seeing normally. Now, if you're using an Amiga 2000 or 3000, you want to make sure you're using version 2.14 of Workbench or later for the stuff we're doing. If you're using a 4000, whatever version of Workbench you have is fine. But the big command that we're going to use here to see a lot of the hidden files is right here, the right mouse button brings up these pull-down menus. And under Window, it says Show Only Icons or All Files. Now, it defaults to Only Icons Chosen. And let's just take a quick look here. We're going to go to the toaster drawer and just use this as an example. What you'll see here is, if you open up the toaster drawer, you're probably going to find a couple of icons in it. Here we have the auto hue one. This, again, lets you auto hue your system. Video toaster, of course, starts our video toaster system. Utilities are a few extra programs. Doesn't look like there's much else going on here. Well, let's do that. Show all files. And lo and behold, the entire sort of hidden world opens up here. There are a ton of different files that we can edit, programs that we can run, all sorts of things that are very, very handy that are hidden within the toaster directory. And in fact, it's the same thing all over the Amiga. So we're going to show you the toaster stuff in just one second. Let me just show you one system thing that I think is fairly important here, and that's if you need to read disk from an IBM PC. A lot of people don't know this. The Amiga 4000 can basically automatically read disk from an IBM PC, including, since the 4000 is a high-density disk drive, high-density disk, 1.44 meg formatted diskettes. Now, if you're using a 2000, you probably don't have the high-density drive. Other than that, everything is the same. We've seen that by doing a show all files, we can get to this hidden world, a whole bunch of different files that we can work with here. We'll come back to the toaster in a little bit. Let's just show you that if we do a show all files just in the general drawer here, brings up a whole bunch of things. A whole bunch of different things here. Now, one of the ones that we want to deal with first off, and it's probably not going to be hidden on your system, is there's two directories here called storage, and one's called devs for devices. And what you want to do is, in the storage drawer, right here, you'll notice that there's a drawer called DOS drivers. Well, if you want to read a disk from an IBM PC, all you have to do is go in and double-click on PC0. What that's going to do is, it's going to make your Amiga's disk drive so it's compatible with a PC disk. You'll put it in, it will be able to automatically read it. And I'll show you that in just one second. Now, if you want to do this on a one-shot basis, do what I just said. Go in, double-click on it. If you want to do it pretty much every time your computer starts up, there's a better way. And what you want to do is, from DOS drivers, open it up here, and you'll see there's a file called PC0. What we're going to do is we're going to drag that to the devs DOS drivers drawer. So drag PC0, click, drag and drop, and there it is. And now with that being run, just close things down here. Now every time you boot your computer, you're going to be able to read the IBM PC disk automatically. Now if you want to do it right now, I'd have to reboot the computer, turn it off, and start it again if I want to be able to read this disk. So let me just double-click on PC0, as we talked about before. All right, now let's just close down these windows. And what you're going to see is when we put the floppy disk in, it's going to come up with two actual icons. One advantage of the Amiga here over Windows, for instance, is that when you put a disk in, something actually shows up on the operating system. But it comes with one that says DF0 colon question mark question mark question mark question mark. And that's basically telling us, don't forget, DF0 is the Amiga's name for its floppy drive. Now, on the other hand, though, up top, it comes up and shows us we got an IBM disk here. Double click, and there's nothing there. Well, why is there nothing there? Well, once again, it's our old friend show all files. We can't see anything here because none of these files have icons attached to them. They're not going to be visible unless you go up to the Windows drawer and pull down show all files. So you see, we're going to use this all over the place. And we got a few pictures here, BMP format pictures. So if we want to use these in the toaster, could we do it directly? We got them here on the computer. Well, no. The reason why is the toaster does not read BMP format, for instance. It also doesn't read TIFF or GIF or any of the other file formats that are out there. It reads Amiga IFF file format. It reads FrameStore format. It's about it. If you want to read these, what you should do is use some sort of file translation program. And there's a whole bunch of programs, so it's a little outside the scope of this tape. But the programs in the Amiga that you'd want to use basically are ASDG's Art Department Pro or GBP's ImageFX. Both of those have a whole bunch of different file loading and saving formats. On the PC, you could use Hijack Pro. On the Mac, you could use the Debabelizer or Debabelizer Lite. And all of these products basically let you convert one file format to another. But for a lot of people, just getting the data over to the computer is the biggest trick. And again, now since you can read the PC disk, you can do it automatically. One more little side note there. The Macintosh can also read and write PC disk, either through Apple File Exchange or under some of the newer system software configurations. Just automatically, you put the disk in, it reads it as a PC disk. And by using this, sort of a third-party intermediary, you can go from Macintosh to the Amiga as well. You're on your Macintosh, you save it out in an IBM format disk, then you load that up onto the Amiga. Just really that easy. You're using the PC disk because it's something common between the Mac and the Amiga. It's one way to do it, and there are other ways, but this is a quick, easy, cheap way built into the operating system. Okay, now that we've seen how to read those, let's get in and start working with some of the toaster files that we can work with here. And I want to start off by talking about just some of the basic problems that you have in the toaster, and one of them is just erasing stuff. So let's go out back to the toaster, hitting Control, Control, Alt, Alt. And if we go to the setup view here, you notice that we have a way of renaming or deleting frame stores. You know, if I don't like this frame store's name or I want to get rid of it completely, there are these handy rename and delete buttons. On the other hand, down here under projects, if I have projects that I no longer want, and you can see we got a few projects on here, how do I rename them? How do I delete them? Well, there's no rename, there's no delete buttons, so you have to use the operating system right now. And it's real simple. Once you've seen how to find these things, it's very, very simple. So let's go out and find what we need to deal with here, show you how to rename and delete, because it's very, very easy, and then apply some of those principles to some of the other files that are in the toaster as well. So this is, again, one of those basic functions. By the way, another area where you end up doing this a lot is with objects or files you've created with Lightwave 3D. There's no way from within Lightwave to erase things. So let's just open this up. And there are three directories that the toaster uses. One is a directory called toaster, which is immediately available. You can see that. The other two file folders, though, you will not see unless you look for them. And so you have to do the show all, which you see is still on from when we put it on before. And the two files you want to look for are one called projects, right here, project, then another one called frame store. Now, you notice it gets a little bit messy with all the icons. So there's another way to view this window that I sometimes like to use because it's a bit easier. It's called view by, and you get a choice of icons, names, dates, or size. So let's go view by, name. And you don't get the pretty pictures, but they all show up in alphabetical order. So let's go to our projects directory. Double click on that, and you can see it says project drawer. And this shows us all the projects that are on this hard drive. And again, this is because we have still the show all files on, view by name is on. And basically, when you have a drawer and you give it one set of attributes, such as show all files, show by name, when you open up the drawers in that drawer, they also take on that attribute. So it's pretty handy. Let's take a look here. You'll notice in the project drawer, we have two types of files. We have some files. Let's go down here to 13, where it says 13.bk.partners, then 13.pj.partners. Now, one thing you'll notice is 13 is 013. So basically, the convention here for this file is three numbers, a dot, then either BK or PJ, then a dot, and then a name. Now, a BK file is a CG book. A PJ file is a project. And if you use a toaster at all, and again, we're taking some basic toaster knowledge for granted here in this tape, but if you've used a toaster at all, you'll know that the book are the 100 pages that CG uses, and books are saved as part of a project. So every project has one and only one book attached to it. Project file itself is storing up a whole bunch of different settings, including what effects are loaded, what speed they're running at, what colors they have up, that sort of thing. So we can change, might want to get rid of these, or we might just want to get rid of a CG book, for instance. And we can do that now, just pick the file, and depends what you want to do to it. We've got really a lot of options here. We can rename it. We would go up to where it says rename. And the sort of thing we'd want to rename, obviously if we want to keep this, we would not rename the number unless we were also renaming the project number. So the name afterwards is what we'd want to change here. So we could change the name of this to anything we want to, pretty much. This is just renaming. And again, all you do is you select the file, pull down where it says rename, or select the file and use the keyboard shortcut. These little things right here show you the keyboard shortcut that go along with these commands. Any of these cases, the A key is the right Amiga key. And the right Amiga key is just the key to the immediate right of the space bar. And what you'll see is if I want to do a rename, right Amiga R brings that requester up. So we can go in here and rename files. We can also delete. See, if we pull down here at the very bottom, it says delete, and if we decide to delete something, it will warn us. It will say if we delete this, we cannot get it back. We could also make a copy. Let's say we wanted to save this and duplicate it. We could pick it, then go to copy, or write Amiga C, and this will make a copy of it, and the copy is cleverly called copy of, and then it has the name here. And then you'd have to go in, if you want to give the copy another name, and just delete the parts you don't want, rename the file. So we could just go in, rename this to, let's say 014, partners 2. And now there's an exact duplicate of this project just with a new name. Otherwise, the things you can do are moving files from one drawer to another, and that's just a matter of dragging and dropping. And when you drag and drop a file from one drawer to another, it doesn't make a copy. It actually takes the file from where you've taken it and moves it over, deletes it from one directory, puts it into another one. So these are basic functions, and when you see how they work, it's pretty straightforward. There's no complex commands to remember or anything like that. You just pick the files you want to deal with, then rename, move, copy, delete, whatever you want to do to them. And let's give you a good practical example of this using frame stores, where some of these functions can really, really come in handy. And this is going to show us a general trick based on the fact that computers are extremely stupid. And we will kind of fool the computer into something that's going to make our life a little bit easier here. So let's just go back to the switcher, and I want to set up the problem for you. And it's a problem you may have run into, which is, in a project, you have no choice on the frame stores that load up. It's basically loading up every single frame store on this hard drive. And, by the way, there's no trick I'm going to show you here. It always does that. Whenever you go to setup and you pick the drive right here under graphics, basically it takes every frame store on that drive and shows it to you in a window there. Now, why does it know to pick every frame store on the drive? Well, what it does is it looks on the disk that you tell it, in this case HD1, and it looks for, in the frame store directory, every single frame that's there. So here's what we're going to do. It's a pretty dumb trick. The computer is very stupid. It's looking on that drive exactly for a directory called frame store. So if we create another directory called frame store and take the original one and rename it to something else, like frame store 2, and you don't have to change very much. Just one little change will confuse the computer here enough. So now our big files, the one that's got every single frame store in it, is in a directory called frame store 2. We've created this new empty directory called frame store. We can just put the files we want into that drawer, and the computer, as dumb as it is, will just find those files. And again, you're going to see this trick in a number of ways on this tape. Just the same little thing here of kind of fooling the computer into looking for something, and it's looking in the wrong place, basically. So let's go in and set that up. This is very, very handy, and you'll see it doesn't take very much time, and it keeps you from having to search through 50 frame stores to find the one you need for a specific project. So let's Control-Control-Alt-Alt-Back. And we have two drives here. The one where our frame stores are is a drive called Frames, and this is the one called HD1 in our system. And let's just find the frame store directory. And we don't see it normally. You're not going to see it unless you do a Show All Files. I warned you we'd be doing this a lot. Open up Frame Store. And again, this shows us these all with the icons. It's a little bit easier for me to read them if I do a view by name. So just running some of the same stuff we've done again here. So here's our general frame store directory. And let's take this directory and rename it frame store 2. Now we're going to go and create a new directory. And so we pull down under window, new drawer, or use the right Amiga end key. And we'll create a new directory called FrameStore. And it's got to be called exactly FrameStore. And one of the reasons, of course, that we renamed FrameStore to FrameStore 2 first is that if we tried to make a new drawer called FrameStore when we already had one called FrameStore, trouble would result. So we don't want that. So let's just find the new one that we created. Here it is. And as you can see, it's empty. Let's do a Show All Files. No, it's showing all files. It's completely empty. It's a new drawer. We just made it. So this is what we want. Now we just take the files that we want, put them into this drawer, and again, that's just a matter of dragging and dropping. You'll notice it takes very, very little time to drag the ones we want over here. In fact, if we click on a file, press and hold down the Shift key, and then click on a couple more, you'll notice that we can pull over multiple files at once, which is handy. Let's just quickly do a view by name here. All right. So now we pulled a few files in. And again, this is the kind of work you could do before a client comes over, before your boss comes into the suite, and it wouldn't take that long. Now, once this is done, all we have to do is go back to the switcher, and lo and behold, when we click here, well, okay, the files are all there. what happened. But what happened was, when you go into setup and you select that hard drive, it basically goes to that drive and reads the FrameStore directory, and it stores that in memory. So right now, it doesn't know we've made the changes. What you have to do is, once you've moved things around in the drive, just go back to setup, reselect the drive, then go back to switcher. And once that little routine is done, once you go through that little ritual, it just shows up with the frames that you want here. Now, there's nothing in the world keeping you from making multiple FrameStore directories. And all you need to do is, and a good example of this, is you could have 5 FrameStore directories, and you could have one called Smith Wedding, one called XYZ Corporation, you know, whatever you want. Then when someone from the Smith Wedding is coming over, just rename Smith Wedding to FrameStore, rename whatever your current FrameStore directory was to something else first, obviously, and then you just have the files that you need. And it lets you keep them in a sort of much more neat and orderly fashion and only have access to the ones you want at that time. And we're going to see a similar trick a couple different times in this tape. All right, now let's work with something a little bit more complex. Let's start to get into toaster paint. And as soon as we get into the paint program, we're going to go in and load up a FrameStore. Just so we have something to operate on here. And Toaster Paint actually gives us a couple of opportunities to play around with some hidden things. Again, this is not meant to be a general Toaster Paint tutorial. We're going to take some Toaster Paint knowledge for granted here. But what we want to show you is the secret, hidden, cool stuff you can do with Toaster Paint, involving two things. One is the AREX macros that actually come with the program. And so this is going to show you how to run AREX programs in a no-brain, simple way. And then we're going to show you how to actually program your own macros, make your own keyboard shortcuts to automate certain Toaster Paint functions. And again, all of this stuff is surprisingly easy. So let's first start off with getting back to the Amiga screen from Toaster Paint, because there's a sneaky way to do it. We don't have to go out to the switcher and use the Control-Alt-Alt function. If we're within Toaster Paint, we can actually press and hold down the left Amiga key, then hit the M key. And every time we hit M, it toggles us through screens. And right here, it's just taking us through these different menus here. And that's because there's nothing active on the Workbench screen. So what we're going to do is we're going to go out and get something up on Workbench. Let's just exit the program quickly. This may happen to you, so just go back to Switcher for a second. We'll use Control, Control, Alt, Alt to get out here once. And all I'm going to do is I'm going to remember that shell window that we opened up at the very beginning of the tape. Let's just open that up. Shell. All right. And I'm just going to make this very small and kind of put it in a corner because I just need something up and running. Go back, enter paint. And again, the only purpose of that shell window is so there's an actual program running on the Amiga screen. Now what you're going to see is, back in paint, we hit left Amiga M. It toggles to the screen the way it did before, and then heads right out to the workbench. Again, this is only going to happen if we've got something running, so just in place of something, just run the shell window or something like that if you need to. It's not working for you, just get that running. Now, once we're out here on Workbench, we can actually do a number of things. And the first thing I want to show you is AREX examples. This is a drawer inside your toaster directory. So let's open up our toaster directory. And again, we cannot see the file here. Let's go to Show All Files. And here it is, the AREX examples drawer. Now, AREX examples gives you a number of AREX scripts for Toaster Paint and for Lightwave and Modeler. And we're going to be talking extensively about the Lightwave and Modeler macros a little bit later on, things you can do in Lightwave and Modeler. But let's talk about the Toaster Paint ones first, because there's a little trickier way to run them. In Modeler, you actually have a macros function that lets you run these AREX scripts. Not so from Paint. It's a little trickier. But not much trickier. Here's what you do. And let's just take an example. First off, there's a drawer down here at the very bottom called T-Paint. And this is in the AREX examples drawer. Double-click on T-Paint. And this is a whole bunch of different macros or AREX scripts for Toaster Paint. Now, what can you do with these scripts? We're not going to drag them. We're not going to drop them. There's two things we could do with them from here. We could run the AREX script. We'll show you how to do that. or we could open it up and read and actually edit the file if we wanted to. Now, we're not going to give you a tutorial on AREX programming here, because basically that would be a whole long tape by people who have big brains. And if you want to learn programming, there's ways to do that. But I want to show you how to run these and how to perform some simple changes on them. And let's just show you first off how we can get in and edit and look at the file if we want to. Because if you're interested in programming, these are actually quite helpful. And the file we're going to look at here is one called EmbossPick, right here. Now, if I double-click on this file, it brings up this little window that says Enter Command Arguments. And what I want to do is, there's two different things I can do. And the first one will be to bring up this file to edit. And you see we're going to be doing this quite a bit later on. So I'm going to hit ED, and all I did is I brought the cursor to the very beginning, ED, then put a space in. And so now, let me just cancel this to go through that again. It goes real quickly, and this is one of those things that seems like I'm actually doing work. I'm not. There's hardly anything going on here. All I do is hit cancel. I double-click on EmbossPick. I go to the front here. And by the way, the quick and easy way to do that is a keyboard shortcut. Shift, left arrow, will move our cursor to the very beginning. Conversely, shift right arrow moves it to the end. So I hit shift left arrow, ED, spacebar, OK. Now what ED is a text editing program that comes with the Amiga. All you have to do is put ED, put a space there, and it will open up whatever file you double-clicked on in the text editor. And here it is right here. And this is a text editor. If I hold the right mouse button down at the top, you see it's got little buttons like save and open. This will let us open up other files, quit. We can move around through the thing. We can also delete lines. You see we've only got three menus here. I'll show you a little something else about that in a second. The idea is this is the script. And if we go through here, you see it actually we can actually read this. This is all a comment. It tells us this program makes an embossed version of whatever image is here. I'll let you read the rest on your own. And this is the program itself right here. All these little four-letter commands are AREX commands. And there's a sheet that comes with this tape of AREX commands for Toaster Paint. You can actually go through and look up a number of these. But again, this requires actually some programming knowledge, because AREX is a programming language like C or Fortran, something like that. You have to go in and be able to write programs. So someone's already written this one for us, and it's a pretty handy one. Let's show you how we would run that. This is how we would go in and view it or edit it. And we will be editing stuff later, but let's just show you how to run it. Double click, go back to the beginning, and instead of hitting ED, hit RX, and leave a space in between there. Now RX means run the AREX program. RX is Rex, basically. It means run the AREX program, whatever you've got selected. So when we hit OK here, it's going to run this AREX program. You're not seeing much happening, are you? Here's what you do. Hit the left Amiga M key again. And this will toggle us through the screens. And here we are on the Toaster Paint screen. This is really important. See the mouse button? Just don't touch it. Just leave it alone for right now. Because it's actually going through and doing this. And you'll know when it's done running this. The problem is, if you were to click the left mouse button now, it would make this screen active. It would bring you back into Toaster Paint, and it would kind of stop the program from doing what it's doing. So just kind of sit back and enjoy. Try to be patient, won't you? Thanks. So let's just let it keep going. And let me explain what it's doing. It's converted the image to black and white. It's copied it to another page. It's offset it slightly. Now it's blurring it twice. Then it's going to go through and do a white XOR, and this produces a photonegative effect. And the whole idea there is just an offset version of an image that is photonegative and slightly blurred, when you do a 50% transparency, produces a nice emboss effect. And just going through and blurring it again right now. And again, this takes a little while. We're on a 4000 here. But the blurring is the part that takes the longest here. You can move around the screen, by the way. Just don't hit the mouse button. And by the way, as long as this may seem to be taking, it's taking a lot less time than it would if we hit it by hand, because we would probably screw things up if we do this by hand. So this is about as quick as you could possibly do these functions, just running them one right after another. By the way, I think it does blur it a few times here. So could you get away with less blur? Perhaps. Now, the fact that the left mouse button actually makes the screen active is an important thing, because there are times when you will move around through the screens. And this is especially true when you're using Control-Control-Alt-Alt. It will look like you're on the screen, but you're really not. You have to click the left mouse button, and by clicking the left mouse button, you make that screen active. So if you ever do a Control, Control, Alt, Alt, go back to the switcher, and nothing's happening there, click the left mouse button to make that active, then things will work. So let's just take a look back. This is all real time, by the way. Take a look at the emboss already in progress. And it's going through and doing a pretty cool little job on giving us an emboss look. And now rendering it out. And here's the way it looks in the program monitor. So fairly neat. That's the emboss function, emboss pick. It's an ARX program, and it works quite well to do something like this. Now, just a couple of little minor tricks while we're here. One minor thing on an emboss is that I mentioned that doing a white XOR produces a photonegative effect. Well, that's true. Now I can click here. See? By the way, clicking, it's stamping down a brush. Because when I clicked there, it had this brush picked up, so it thought I wanted to drop it. I don't. So I'm hitting the right mouse button to make it stop. Then the undo key. And this will happen when you're done with the emboss pick. I've now got this giant brush floating around on my mouse. No fun at all. Quick way to get rid of that is the period key. The period key in Toaster Paint is the keyboard shortcut that turns it to a single dot brush. So let me just show you this other interesting little thing here. If we go to XOR mode with white chosen, and you've got something that's already embossed, a white XOR with the sliders up full reverses the emboss. Those things that were raised look lowered, things that are lowered look raised. So if I were to undo what I just did there and hit W for whole screen in Paint, it'll actually go through and just flip around the emboss. So now rather than being inset, the NewTek letters are raised and vice versa. So just if you want a different look, just a quick little thing there. And of course, if I wanted to actually make this look like an image, it's grayscale here, which is a little boring. You can always go in, use colorize mode, pick a color. I'll use sort of a spicy brown mustard yellow here, and then run my transparency controls down a bit, and hit W again. And again, W is the keyboard shortcut for whole screen. If any of the stuff in Toaster Paint here, how moving around menus completely throws you, get to know Toaster Paint a little bit better. Because again, this is not meant to be the Toaster Paint tutorial tape, but just a couple of little things since we're in here. Just render this out. And you see we have a decent little color background now. And again, this is the kind of thing we could put CG over, or any sort of things you want to do with it. This is the way we run AREX programs, but you notice I've been using a few keyboard shortcuts in Toaster Paint. And one of the biggest secrets in the toaster is that you can actually write your own keyboard shortcuts. And you can actually have them do multiple things, therefore you're writing macros. Now, you remember before I talked about programming and said you might need a lot of brain capacity to do it. Well, that's true in general, but it's not true with these keyboard shortcuts. So let me just load up another picture here, show you a function, and again, since we're creating macros, what I want to create is macros for things that I do frequently. So let me just give you an example of something that we do frequently. Show you how we go in, create our own keyboard shortcuts, and then create one on the fly that we can then use. So let's just do that. Let's start by loading up a picture. And one thing that I will often do is if I'm blurring a picture, I'm just going to load this up as an example, but it could be anything. If I'm blurring a picture, I usually don't blur it once. I usually go to Blur 2 mode, and then I redo the blur, then redo it, then redo it. So for instance, this is often what I will do. My transparency controls should be up all the way. I will go to Blur mode. Let me just go back to this screen so you can see we're in Blur mode. But I don't like just blur, so I hit the 6 key again to go to Blur 2 mode. And we'll draw over something, let's say. That will blur it once. Then I'll hit the redo key to do it again. And again. And again, let's say. So that's what I do when I blur things. Now, I don't want to have to do that all the time. I mean, there's a whole bunch of little commands there. So wouldn't it be nice if I could hit one button, and it would take whatever I just drew over, go to Blur 2 mode and blur it 3 times. Well, okay, it would be nice. And so let's just program a keyboard shortcut that does that. And in order to do this, we're going to use another file here. Let's just hit Left Amiga M. And by the way, play around. Now that you see how to run these AREX programs, go through and run them to your heart's content. There's a whole bunch of interesting little ones here. Sepia Tone does automatic sepia toning. There's one that creates storyboards out of frames. Again, feel free to go through and run these. Most of them tend to be towards the weird and not that useful one. For instance, there's one here called TP Smiley, which makes a giant 70s happy face. But it's in there, it's free, so you might want to try this. But again, Sepia Tone, a few of the other ones are kind of interesting. So here's the new file we want to look at, and this is where Toaster Paint gets all its keyboard shortcuts from. In the Toaster directory, there is a drawer called Toaster Paint Startup, right here. We open that up, so it's Toaster Paint Startup, and inside that directory, keyboard.txt. Now, keyboard.txt is the file that Toaster Paint takes its keyboard shortcuts from. And we're going to open it up and edit it as a text file. And we've already seen how to do that. You double-click on the file, go to the beginning, just write me, just a shift left arrow there, ED space, OK. And here's the file. And if we just scroll through this a little bit, kind of makes your head ache, doesn't it? Don't worry, this is quite staggeringly simple. Let me show you an example of a keyboard shortcut we've used already, one that we showed you, show you how it's actually programmed in here now, then give the idea what we're going to do, because it's really very, very easy. The one we're going to show you is redo. Now remember, the redo keyboard shortcut is A, and let's just go up here, and what you'll see is, starting from the top of the file, there's a whole bunch of lines that say boot. Now anything that says boot in the front are commands that are run at the very beginning. We're going to come back to that in just a few minutes and show you how to change the default brush type that comes up, for instance. But let's, for right now, just talk about the keyboard shortcuts themselves. Right below the boot is a small A key and just a space between it, then it says redo. And below that, capital A, space, redo. Small B, space, SCIS, S-C-I-S, so on and so forth. Now the first thing there, the letter, is the letter of the keyboard shortcut. So when it says small a, that means when you hit small a, run this. And the command that's telling it to run is redo. All the commands in Toaster Paint are these four-letter AREX commands. Every single command is just four letters. Sometimes four letters with numbers after it, as you'll see when we start drawing stuff, but all four-letter commands. The command in AREX to do a redo is redo, that's convenient. It shows you here that when you hit a small a, it does a redo. Hit a capital A, it does a redo. It also shows you when you hit a small b, it does a SCIS, S-C-I-S. And this over here, this is just a comment where it says brush scissors. That's just something the programmer put in to remind themselves and anybody else reading this file what this function actually does. So here's the way you program these. And I want to show you one just dropping it down a little bit here, which is the Shift K key for clear screen. Because this is where you start to get an idea of the power. You notice it says Shift K, Shift K, Shift K three times. And each Shift K is a different command next to it. Well, what it does is when Toaster Paint's keyboard shortcuts encounter something where you've got the same letter done a number of times, it will run every command in order top to bottom. So, first it does CBX0. And the comment here says that means choose color 0. Color 0, by the way, is black. It means the first color in the palette. Then the next command that it runs is CLRS, clear screen. Then the next command it runs is CBX1, which is choose color 1, which is white. And what this means is when you're hitting Shift K, it's picking black as the current color, right there, then running a clear screen, which will clear the screen to black, then picking white as your current color. So, let's just take a look at this and see if it's right. I hit Shift K. Yep, clears the screen to black and white's our current color. So, what have we learned here? What we've learned is that you can run multiple functions in a row, and this is how we can program macros. And so, let's program one. And you will notice when we go back to our little edit window that there is nothing here for the small k. The small k, there's no keyboard shortcut that uses small k. So let's make that our blur keyboard shortcut. Now it's just a matter of thinking through what we want this to do. What do we want our keyboard shortcut to do? And in my case, let's say I want it, so when I draw something, any shape, it will automatically put put me to blur mode, and then redo it 3 times. Well, one problem is, do I want to do that before or after I've done? Well, probably after I've drawn something. So what I'd want to do is, I draw a rectangle, let's say. Then when I hit K key, it undoes the rectangle. So let's make our first command here, undo. And the four-letter command for undo, and you can look this up on the page that comes with the tape, is, not surprisingly, undo. So, small letter K, type in undo. So now it is undrawn the rectangle we've drawn. Next, put another small K here. Next, we want to go to blur mode. So we type in blur. By the way, blur is the four-letter shortcut for blur mode. If we want to go to blur 2, which is the blurrier blur, we could either do 2 blur commands in a row or use blue 2, which is what we'll do. So it undoes it, goes to blur 2 mode. Now, just to make this completely idiot-proof, I want to make sure that my transparency sliders are all the way up. Because let's say I'm a complete moron, which is often the case, by the way, and my transparency sliders are down at the bottom. Well, this means it's not going to have any blurring effect at all. Not very useful. So we want to set both our center slider and our edge slider up to the maximum position. And, again, looking at it, keyboard shortcuts for that, the AREX commands for that, are max, M-A-X, E, all right in a row. And that means max edge slider. And again, you can look this up on the sheet, but it kind of makes sense. Then small k, max C. This will put the sliders up. Now, our sliders are up. We're in the right mode. Everything should be set. Let's have it redo. We've already seen that one. Then have it redo. And then have it redo. Done. Now, if you want to make this a little clearer when you're looking at it, I could actually go before the keyboard shortcut and just put a blank leading space. And if I wanted to, as we've seen here, I could actually add my own comments to the end. So I could say, you know, undo, that's kind of self-explanatory. Blue 2, I can put here, go to blur 2 mode. And I could put here, sliders up. Then I could put down here, redo 3 times. And this is just so future generations can look at this and marvel at the complexity. And again, you see, what we're doing here is not very complex. Anybody can do this. It's just a matter of thinking through what you want to do, then programming it. So once we're done here, we save this file. We are saved. Let's close this up. Go back to the program. And let's try out our miraculous new keyboard shortcut. We'll just load up something. And I'll stop it right about here, because we get enough of the idea from this part here. I'm going to draw a rectangle around it. Should be a filled rectangle, probably. Yeah, good. Filled rectangle. And I'll put myself into a different, just to beta test this, I'll throw my sliders off. So, there we go. Now I hit the K key, and nothing happens. This is real similar to what happened before when we went back to Switcher. Problem is Toaster Paint reads this keyboard shortcut file once when it initially loads up. So if you change the keyboard shortcut file with Toaster Paint already loaded, it's not going to be able to keep track of what you've done. So what we're going to do here is let's exit out of Toaster Paint, quitting it, shutting it down completely, then restart, and now it will reread the Toaster Paint file. Now, if you want to, you can make a copy of your Toaster Paint keyboard.txt file before you go in and make any other changes. And that's probably not a bad idea if you're a nervous type and you don't want to screw anything up too badly. All you do is go there before you start editing it, pick it, copy it, and then you've got a backup file that you can use. But in this case, we've done everything properly. We load up the file. I'll try it out, draw over an area, hit K, undoes. I can see down here it's in blur 2 mode. and it's blurring it a few times. It works. Now the next example we're going to do is a little bit more difficult. What we're going to do is we're going to have it draw a streak, a transparent light to dark streak, and it's going to automatically emboss it and put a drop shadow under it. And you see it's a little bit more difficult, but it's not much more difficult. The first key is just setting it up and determining exactly what we want to do. And again, a lot of the trick of creating these macros is figuring out what you want to do in Toaster Paint first. The programming part's easy. So let's just clear out our screen here and start from scratch. And we're just going to go in and create a real simple range color background here. Going from sort of a lightish blue to a sort of lightish purple. And let's just set our sliders up top here and hit W. And again, this is just going to create a color spread. This is no big deal here, but we're going to create a streak, and we're going to do it manually, and we're going to keep track of a few things. And this is where you might want to have a paper and pencil handy to write some of these settings down, but it's really pretty straightforward. So let's just go through here and think about how we would set this up. And what we're going to do is we're going to do the steps one at a time, thinking it through, and then we're just going to translate into that writing a macro. So let's double-click on this. Go to Ed, leaving a space there. And let's find a blank spot. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the Shift A key here. Because we've got two keys assigned to redo, so I'm going to get rid of one of them. And again, if you're nervous at all about this, make a copy of your keyboard Todd text file. You can always go back to the original one. I am not nervous. I am boldly adventuring forward here. So we got the capital A key selected. And what we're going to do is let's just go through this in a step-by-step way and think about what we do to create a streak. So the first thing I would do is I would go to a different brush type. I don't want the round brush. I would probably go to the smallest brush here. So let's program that. Go back. So the first thing our macro is going to do is the first thing that I did here, and that's going to change our brush type. And the keyboard shortcut for brush type, the AREX command I mean, is BRT and then a number. And it's 1 through 7, basically. So BRT, which is brush type 1, is that single pixel brush. Okay? Next step. Next thing I would do is I would pick the filled rectangle tool. Now, the filled rectangle tool, let's go through and set that up here. First, you have to tell it to go to draw rectangle mode. And again, all of these things are listed on that piece of paper you get. So I know it's D-R-R-E, four-letter command, draw rectangle. And then I have to go flan, a popular dessert, but also flan is basically fill-on, F-L-O-N, fill-on. Flof, F-L-O-F, is just fill-off. So we go to flan. Let's go to the next one here. So we got the filled rectangle with this small brush. And now I would go to normal mode. And I could actually have it pick a color. So it forces you to make this streak whatever color, you know, any color, always blue. But that's a little inflexible. What I'm going to do is I'm going to have it take whatever color we've got currently set up. So I'm not going to change the color, but I am going to change the mode. And what I want to do is go to normal mode. The AREX command for normal mode is PMCL. That's paint mode clear, PMCL. You remember that the AREX command for blur mode was the four-letter command blur. Well, a number of the paint modes, if you look at that sheet, are PM something. Paint mode, CL is paint mode normal, as we've just seen. PMDN is darken. PMLN is lighten, for instance. So we'll just go to paint mode normal. Now comes the fun part. We have to draw, and we have to give it exact coordinates when we go through and draw here. And so what we're going to do is we need a way to view the coordinates. And the way in Toaster Paint to do that is click on the mode button here. And this will give you coordinates as you move around the screen. And the coordinates, the only thing that's sort of funky about them is you notice right here, for instance, I am at 0 on X, let's say 50 on Y. Well, as soon as I start to draw, the coordinates change to showing not my current coordinates, but how far I've moved from where I originally was. So right now it shows 102x, 45y. That doesn't mean I'm at 102x and 45y. It means that I'm at 102 plus 0, which is 102, but I'm at 45 plus 50, so I'm really at 102.95. I told you it was fun. That's the only thing you have to bear in mind, is that it's not showing you actual coordinates, but the coordinates become relative at that point. Okay, let's not sweat that. Let me just undo, because this isn't what we want. Let's try drawing our streak again. And I think starting at about 0x, 50y works. We'll drag it across all the way to 752x. Let's try 90y. And let's see how that looks. Let's hit F10 to render it. That's pretty good, maybe a little high on it. So I undo and draw again. Also, I can see that there's one other problem here. I want this to be a streak, not just a solid line. And right now, our settings are wrong for that. Basically, one of them is, they're both up. It's not transparent at all on either side. So this is kind of a bad thing. So we have to go through and set this properly. So let's figure out our coordinates, but then we have to go in and remind it to set our sliders in the right position. So rather than starting it, there, I'll start it at 75. And I lost my coordinates when I went down here. If I need to check them again, all I have to do is bring back the toolbar here and then move to the bottom, and I can see, okay, I've moved to 751 by 171. So we'd round it off to 170. Let's just see how this looks. That's fine. That's a good-looking streak right there. So let's say that our coordinates for this are going to be 0, 75, and then 751, 170. Okay, that's what we're going to set up for coordinates. Now, we're going to go and draw that in a second, but let's set up first off the transparency controls. Remember, we used the max C and max E before. Now we're going to use max C min E, which is going to give us maximum and minimum. That's all it is. Have one of the sliders go all the way up, the other one go all the way down. But in order to do that, of course, we need to switch this control here to be a left to right gradient, and then move it all the way over to the left. So we basically, again, everything we do here in the program, that has to translate into a keyboard shortcut. That's a translate in the file into an AREX command of some kind. So if we were going to set it up like this, that's four commands. One to put it into this mode, another one to move it over to the side, one to move the slider up, another one to move the slider down. And the order you do them in is important, because if we don't take ourselves into this mode first, let's say we decide to move the slider down first, and then this slider up, well, in this mode of the hotspot controls, they move together. So we move it down, and we move the other one up. Well, they're moving at the same time. So what we have to do is, in order, select this type of control, move it over, then put one down, one up. So let's just set that up here. So the first thing we need to do here is toggle off the control for that slider. And the way we do that is a command HVOF, horizontal and vertical off. Then we need to do HARR, H-A-R-R, which is going to make it a horizontal slider. And then we want to move it all the way over to the left. And the way we do that is with another script command here, which is POT H. In other words, the position of the horizontal slider. And then this is one of those things where you have to actually enter a value afterwards. And these are hexadecimal values. Far over to the left side is dollar sign, then four zeros, 0000. Over to the far right-hand side would be dollar sign 8000. And it's just hex numbers, and it's just far left, far right. So now we've set that up. Now we can set it up so the center slider is at maximum. So max E, max C, actually, because C is the first letter in center. So just setting this up right. And again, I'm being careful in going through and doing this, but I just hit max E by accident. If I hadn't noticed that, the script just would have run incorrectly. Then I would have to go back and find the bonehead mistake I made. And that's the whole trick here, is just not making those mistakes. So anyway, this one caught in time. Then min E, We want the edge sliders set to a minimum. And now we've set up our sliders, we're in the right draw mode, now we have to have it draw. And the way we do this is with commands called pen down and pen up. In other words, where should it start drawing, where should it stop drawing. So first we will run pen down, P-E-N-D, pen D. And then we give it the X, Y values. And remember, we're starting at 0 on X, and we decided to do 75 on Y. Then our pen should go up at, we decided, 751 and 170. There we go. So this is going to draw the slider right across. Now, this will just draw a simple streak, and there's no problem with this. This would work. It would be okay. But let's get a little fancier here and add a light and a darken at the top. This will create an emboss effect where we add a thin strip of light and a thin strip of dark. And in fact, if we draw another one underneath it, it will create a shadow. If we were to do this on the graphic now, let me just show you how it would look. What we do is, with these set up like this, we'd go to lighten mode. We draw a lighten across the top. Then we go to darken mode. We do a darken along the bottom. Don't forget the rectangle that I drew here isn't actually fading, so. And anyway, here's the emboss effect. Lighten at the bottom, lighten at the top, darken at the bottom. If you want to get fancy and put a drop shadow on it, you'd actually just draw it below here. So it ends something like that. And that would look like this. Where it puts the darken, and below that, the darken actually creates the effect of a shadow. Easy. We switch to lighten mode, draw a rectangle, switch to darken mode, draw a rectangle. So we're already in draw rectangle mode. Our sliders are already set the way we want them. So let's go to lighten mode first. Remember, that's paint mode, lighten. Then our pen is going to start drawing at exactly the same place it drew before. So we do a pen D, 075. But now we want it to actually stop drawing, not all the way at the bottom, because that would lighten the whole thing. But let's say, 20 pixels down. So instead of our pen up being 751, 170, it'll be 751, which will put it at the far right-hand side. But let's say 95. That's it so far. So this will draw a thin lighten, 20 pixels tall across. Now we go to darken mode. And we want this one to start drawing 20 pixels above the bottom. So far left-hand side, which is 0 on X. And again, you notice before every one of these, I'm putting a capital A. We've actually got, if we take a look back at the script we've done, we've got quite a few things here in a row. But pen down at 0 and 20 above the bottom position. Well, our bottom position is 170. That's our bottom Y value. So we'll make it 0, 150. And then our pen up position should be 751. And we could put it exactly at the bottom, which would be 170. But we're going to draw it a little bit below that. Let's say 30 pixels below to add the drop shadow. So we'll make our bottom position 200. So now it's drawing a larger rectangle across and under. We are done. This is it. And if we've set this up properly and we haven't mistyped anything, this will work. And let's just save this file. Okay. And again, to test this, we need to quit Toaster Paint and restart. And we will just load any old picture here. But what we should get here is, when we hit the capital A key, a nice streak built immediately across the picture. And obviously, you can go back and change this. And you see, since we can draw this any way we want to, you actually can do some very, very powerful things. And on the sheet that came with it, you'll find a couple of other scripts for doing things like over-the-shoulder graphics or other little embossed things that you can program as well. But if we were to hit this one, Shift-A, takes whatever color we've got, in this case, white. There's the lighten, there's the darken. And let's hit the F10 key to render it out. There it is. Now, again, if we wanted a different color, we would have picked a different color before we ran the macro. Also, looking at it, I might decide that, well, it's probably a little too thick there. Just a matter of going in and changing the numbers. Instead of having it go on the light in here down to 95, let's have it go to 85. Instead of having it start at 150, let's have it start at 160. So it's finishing higher and starting lower, basically. And then the drop shadow, I'm okay with, actually. So we'll have it end at 200 still. Just resave. Then debug it. And again, you get the idea here. And again, if this were difficult, I really wouldn't be showing it to you. The idea here is play around with it. And how much time does this save you in the long run? Well, if you create graphics on a fairly frequent basis, this can save you a ton of time. There's actually one other thing I might want to do is you could actually have it so it automatically renders it out to the screen. VWCO, that's view composite, and that would just output it automatically to the Toaster's frame buffers. So you could add that if you want to. Again, I'm not going to do it here, but let's just see our new debugged keyboard shortcut. We'll pick a color that we think is appropriate. Do purple, Shift-A, and it draws the purple bar across, fading. Then should do a thinner lighten and darken with a drop shadow. And there it is. The instant streak sort of avoids the work there. So this is very, very handy. And again, you can go in and program a lot of different keyboard shortcuts, create your own macros, and really sort of simplify your work and customize it. If you don't like this bar, if you often do lower thirds, you don't have a bar that automatically does that. Just assign it to any key that's not being used or that's being used in a redundant way within that. Also, another thing you could do with this, by the way, is the same trick we showed you before with the frame stores. There's nothing that would keep you from having four or five different keyboard.txt files. Remember, Toaster Paint's looking for a file called keyboard.txt. So if you have one called keyboard.txt2, it's going to ignore that. Just change the name of that to keyboard.txt, and you can actually have custom keyboard shortcut files for, you know, whatever function you're doing. So if you're going into a normal paint session, you might have your normal one loaded up. But then if you just want to create some, you know, graphics using standard tools like streaks and boxes quickly, you can have a file you programmed already and hit the buttons and just bring it up right there. All right, now let's start to get into Lightwave, where we have some other uses of AREX, but it's a little more direct. There's a number of macros that come with Lightwave, and if you're a Lightwave user, or even if you're not that heavy a Lightwave user, there's a lot of things here that will save you a ton of time. So let's just exit out of Toaster Paint and start to get into Lightwave. And actually, the first thing I want to show you in Lightwave doesn't have anything to do with the AREX macros. The first thing I want to show you, and let's, again, we're solving a problem, so let's explain the problem first, is the fact that, let's say I go to Object, Load Object. Well, I've got DF0, HD0, HD1, RAM. And if I click on any of these, okay, this is nice. I've got these things, but I've got a directory in my system called VT1. Well, there's no VT1 button up here. Let's say I was using a SideQuest. Well, there's no SideQuest button up here either. So what do I do if I want to kind of very quickly get that up? Well, I have to customize these buttons. So that's one thing we're going to show you how to do. Here's the other problem. Let's say I'm in the camera mode and I decide to go to high res. Well, this warning comes up telling me that this option is not necessary for video work. Same thing, by the way, if I go and turn on trace shadows, tells me this option may greatly increase rendering time, or trace reflections, or trace refractions. All right, just to make sure you get this, this is the last time you need to hear it. If you go to high res or print res, it's not necessary for video work. If you turn on trace shadows, trace reflections, or trace refractions, it will increase rendering time. Any questions? No? Good? Okay. You never need to see these again. When I hit these buttons, I do not want to see it come up with that. And what we're going to do to change both of these things, to change our requesters, and to put us into expert mode, is to change something called the Lightwave config file. This is another file that we can edit. And again, there's a just get to it the same way we did from Paint. Left Amiga M lets us toggle back out here. Let's close down our Paint screen. If we're editing that, just close that down. And let's find the Lightwave config file. Well, Lightwave config is in your Toaster directory, inside a directory called 3D. Now, 3D actually houses a bunch of things. It houses the objects, images, scenes, envelopes, all those sorts of things that are associated with LightWave. So again, if you want to go in and delete, let's say, some objects, this is where you do it. You go to 3D, Objects, you just pick the object, then go to Delete, or rename it, or move it into another drawer, so on and so forth. Okay. Now, the file we want to deal with here is LightWave config. To edit it, double-click on it, and well, it's coming up with this little thing. It's not working. It says the icons have no default tool. And this will occasionally happen. This will confuse you and make you want to quit the business. So rather than that happening, let me show you the easy way around this. All you have to do is select the file. Notice it's highlighted now. And I'm going to go to Info, Information right here, which is Write Amiga I. Write Amiga I. And you see it does not say executable. It's not listed. This is why it's not coming up. This is why it's not coming up with that little window that lets you type in add. So just change it to executable by clicking the button. Then hit save. Now I double click on it and still doesn't work. What you have to do is shut down the drawer. Because if we bring this up again, you'll see it says executable. Close the drawer down, then reopen the drawer, then double click on it and it pops up. Weird? Yes. Coincidence? I think not. You have to go through that and it will somehow work. Okay? So let's just go through here. We've double-clicked on it. Select Ed. And here we are. We can edit it now. Okay, the first thing I want to do is put us in expert mode so we don't get those irritating warning messages. So I go to expert mode equals 1. It is on 0 normally, which means you're not in expert mode. Put on expert mode 1, you're now in expert mode. Save this file, of course. We've seen that already. Close it down. We'll go back. Now when we click on print res, okay, the irritating warnings come up. But wait, we know about this. We know that if we shut down LightWave and then restart it, because the way computers work, it's going to reread the file at the beginning. And now when we go in and we hit on print res, it's not going to show us, nope, still doing it. Here's why. And this is an important thing. If you thought you were on to me, guess again. Here's what's happening. And this is only with LightWave, but it's really important. If you're going to edit the LightWave config file, do not have LightWave up and running. Repeat, shut down LightWave before you edit the file. And this is important because LightWave actually, here's what it does. It's not just that it reads it in at the beginning like Toaster Paint does. It reads it in at the beginning and then rewrites it. And any changes you've made get ignored completely, because it reads it into memory at the beginning, holds that in memory, then rewrites it with any changes you made in LightWave. But if you've gone out and you've edited the file with LightWave up, it'll completely ignore those changes. Now here's an example of that. Let me just show you why it works this way. You'll notice that under the record menu here, I don't have anything. No record setup, no record command, nothing like that. And indeed, if I were to open up this file, take a look at it, right down here, record setup 1, none. Oops, let me get rid of that. Record setup 2, none. Record delay 0. First frame delay 0. Okay. Close this down. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go in, I'm not going to edit the file, I'm actually going to make those changes here. I go to record, record setup, I'll just enter a bunch of garbage. Same thing under record setup 2. I'm just entering garbage to change this, by the way. You might actually use these settings, but your single frame controller may vary. Actual mileage may vary here. So try it with whatever your controller is. A lot of people don't use single frame controllers anymore, though. So some of these commands are less than relevant. But the point here is I've entered a couple garbage things here, and I'll enter 5 for our first frame delay, and then 3.14159 for our extra first delay. I will exit out of switcher. I will shut down LightWave. Then I will re-enter LightWave. And what you're going to see is any of the record commands that I entered there have been remembered. And in fact, if we were to reload this file, bring it up, lo and behold, here's the garbage that we entered. Here's the numbers that we entered. And so what it did was it remembered the record settings that we put in, saved them as part of the file. You see, they're actually there as part of the file, then brought them up. And this is a good thing. The assumption here is if you change the record settings, if you have a certain setup that you need to use, it's always what you're going to use. So it remembers that for all eternity. Otherwise, it's going to forget it. So the key here is that if you want to save what you're doing in the file. Exit Lightwave, completely shut it down, and then edit from that point. Now, one other thing that I might mention here is that if you somehow destroy this file, you don't even need to make a copy of it. Like the one I've got here, I'm not real happy with. One trick is that if I delete the Lightwave config file, I'm just going to go in, get rid of it. So there's no Lightwave config file anymore. If I go back to Toaster, start it up, Lightwave again, it automatically generates its own new Lightwave config file. It won't remember any of the settings we put in before. This is a fresh, virginal Lightwave config file with nothing in it, basically, except the default settings. But again, let me shut this down so I can edit it properly. This is handy because it means you cannot mess this up too much. Reopen 3D, and there it is, our new Lightwave config file. Okay, so let's actually, now that we've shut down Lightwave, now that we've seen the mistakes you can make, let's go in and make a couple of changes here. And the first one is the one we talked about before. Let's go in and put ourselves in expert mode. Just expert mode instead of 0 should be 1. And we'll talk about those changes when we go back. But let's go up to the top of the file here. This is pretty handy. It says File Requester Preset 1, 2, 3, and 4. These can be anything you want. You can set these any way your heart desires. Let's say you don't like the preset settings that come with the program. Okay, just change them. So for instance, I've got a drive called VT1, and that's where my toaster is. Well, here's a way to read this. File Requester Preset 1, 2, 3, and 4. 1 is just the first one on the left. 2 is the second one. 3 is the third one. 4 is the farthest on the right. So let's change it. I don't have a drive DF1 here, so I'll change it to the name Toaster. T-O-S-T-E-R. It's not that I don't know how to spell. That you can only use 6 characters there, so I got rid of the A. So it looks kind of like Toaster. You could go T-O-A-S-T-R, but keep it to 6 characters there. So that's my Toaster directory. Then I leave a space, and I put the drive name, VT1. And this is just as it would appear on the setup screen. You have to put the colon at the end there. Now, another thing you could do is have a button that automatically goes to the frame stores directory. So instead of DH0, let me change this to HD1. We'll put this to be HD1. And instead of the RAM disk, which is using your computer's memory as a hard disk space, I hardly ever use that. What I want to do is I want to, let's call it frames. And frames will just be my frame store directory. And again, we're storing the frame stores on another drive here. So the frames are on HD1 on a drive called frame store. Okay, we've made a number of changes. We will go up here, save the file, shut this down, Control, Control, Alt, Alt, back, load up Lightwave, and the first thing you'll notice, go to Objects, Load Object, hey, Toaster HD1 Frames. Hit on Frames, it brings me straight to my HD1 Frame Store directory, just as we entered there. Hit on Toaster, brings me to VT1. This is extremely handy. Now, if you want to get back, and here's just another general Lightwave hint. Let's say you go to your frames directory. Now I want to get back to where my objects are. There's 2 quick ways to do that. One of them is to clear out this path completely. And the slow way to do that is go over here and then use the delete key. That'd be kind of slow. One quick way is the right Amiga X keyboard combination. And that's if you have anything entered in this path name here, hit right Amiga X, clears out everything. Now with this path requester cleared out, I hit the return key, and it brings me back to the top, sort of an overview of my envelopes, images, motions, objects, scenes, and surfaces directory. Now I hit objects, right there I'm back to my objects directory. Another option, if you want to do a little bit more typing, is clear this out. Let's say I want to get to my images directory, just type in the word images. Here's my images directory. So there's 2 different ways to get yourself back to where your objects and stuff like that are, rather than using these parent buttons to search aimlessly through your drive to try to find things. The one I like to use is just get rid of everything that's in there, hit return, then click on objects, you're right there. All right, now we've got this set where we want it. Let's check on the expert mode. We set that to 1, so now we hit high res. Lo and behold, it just goes here without giving us the warning. Also, if we turn on any of these buttons, it doesn't warn us. Now, we're in expert mode, and let's just take an example to see how this affects things. If I were to load up an object, let's say, any old object, and I were to save this object over itself, I'm going to hit save, and I'll leave the same name. So potentially this could erase the object that's there, replacing it with our new one. We're in expert mode, though, so see, it still warns you. Remember, this is expert mode, not suicide mode, for instance. So what it does is it just gets rid of those irritating warnings that we showed you and a couple of other irritating ones, but nothing you need to worry about. It doesn't keep you from, you know, it doesn't make it so you can erase files easy or anything like that. There's no possible harm you can do to your computer by being in expert mode. You already have the knowledge. You are an expert now. I hereby ordain you. Okay, that's what we're going to cover in Lightwave, changing that Lightwave config file. You may notice there's also a modeler config file. We never need to go in and edit it, though. The same way we showed you in Lightwave, that you can actually change the file by changing settings here, well, everything in the modeler config file you can change that way, too. Let's head into modeler a little bit, because this brings up a couple of points here. First off, under options, you'll notice you have things like polygons, triangles, quadrangles, or automatic, whether they're one-sided or two-sided, the curved division, coarse, medium, or fine. Well, if we look at the mod config file, you'll notice it has stuff like, oh, the curved division, or whether they're one-sided or two-sided, or whether they're quadrangles, triangles, or whatever. So you really don't need to worry about this too much. Nothing you need to think about. All you have to do to change the mod config file is just change things in modeler. Now, the big thing in modeler, though, is the fact that you've got a number of AREX macros. And they are stored here under the macro function. This brings up a list of all the AREX macros. And there were really a couple problems with the AREX macros. One of them was they weren't described real well in the manual, and that's supported real well there. And the other problem is that there's a number of macros that are actually hidden. Now, let me give you an example of a problem that we need to solve. There's a hidden macro that can solve very, very easily. What I'm going to do is I'm going to load up here an object, and on the food directory, I will load up the pop can. Hit the A key to view it. And what you'll notice is, let's say we try to do a bend on this pop can. Well, it's not working real well. And that's because there's only one polygon. Let me undo that. There's only one polygon from here to here. And so what's happening with this one polygon, it's not bending, it's just torquing the polygon. Now, if we had a number of polygons dividing that, this would work real well. Then we could bend it, and we wouldn't have any problems. Now, if this sounds familiar, you might own another tape in this series where we took this very can and solved this very problem, and we used a number of different steps to do it. In fact, let's take a look at the tape right now. Forward fast, if you want to, slow the machine down, and you can try to get all this, but here's all the steps we had to go through. You don't want to do that. Here's a better way, and it's a macro called Julian. Now, the problem with the Julian macro is that it does not show up on the macros menu. It is a hidden macro. You will find no Julian macro here. You will find, and a few people know some of the macros here, useful ones like haiku, which automatically generates a haiku. It's just there. It's like the smiley face. Not very, very useful. Although it is actually a useful program example, which is one of the reasons it's there. And it's kind of fun. But it's not anything useful in a day-to-day 3D setting. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to use the macro called add macro. It's at the top of the list here, because it begins with an A. You'll notice this is in alphabetical order. And the add macro lets you add macros to your macro list. Basically, it finds a macro. So we're going to run add macro here. Just highlight it and release. And then it shows us a list of the macros. And you will see here, julienne.lwm. Select it, hit OK. And now when we go back to the macro list, hey, there's the julienne macro. Now, if you want to save this macro as part of your list permanently, all you have to do is go up to the top where it says configure list. And then you see it says macro list. Load, save, clear, just hit save. Give it the same name, And basically, we've now saved the macro list over itself with Julian as part of it. And what you'll see is, we go back to layout, if we shut down Modeler, restart it up, next time we come back in, there's Julian right there. So this is the quickest way to add these macros, and again, there's a couple of them that are just completely hidden from you. Now, Julian is incredibly useful. Let me show you how it would work. We would go, we will load up the pop can again. And rather than go through all the steps that we had to go through before, all we do is we pick these center polygons. And then we want to split it into more divisions top to bottom. Now, the Julian macro, when you run it, it only has a couple of settings here. One of them is axis, one of them is number of divisions. We're going on the y-axis, we want to split it up like this, top to bottom. So we pick y-axis. How many divisions? 20 looks pretty good to me. So we hit OK. Then you wait a couple seconds. And what it's doing is it's going through all the work we had to do before, pulling out the polygons and resegmenting it. But it's a lot easier and quicker. There you go. Done deal. That was real time, by the way. Go to the bend function, click and drag. You see the bend works a little bit better. This is an example of an extremely simple macro, but the point we're bringing here is that there are some macros that are hidden from you that you do not see normally. You can easily add them to your list. By the way, let's say you decide that you might not, you know, need the haiku macro all that often, so you don't need that as part of the regular list. How do you do that? Just go back to configure list, pick the old haiku macro, and then get rid of, then hit delete. Then hit save list. Okay, no more haiku. Has it erased it from the disk? No, not at all. What the list is really, is it's a referent to the file. It's just saying, make this visible as part of the regular list. It doesn't erase it from the computer at all. In fact, if you decide a few weeks later you really need the haiku macro, you can go back and it's still right there. Just do the add macro and it will come right back to you. So by using the add macro and the configure list function, you can go in and make a nice, clean, lean list. It just has the functions that you want on it. Now let's go through and show you a few more of these functions, because there's a number of macros that I think are interesting and kind of helpful for setting up some things. And let's actually start just by adding a couple of macros here that might not be on your list. First one is called Light Swarm. Do an add macro to add that. Next one we're going to add is called P Clone. And finally, we're going to add one also down the list called Prick. No jokes, okay? Light Swarm, Particle Clone, P Clone, and Prick, all with .lwm after them. And these show up on the menu as Light Swarm. Light Swarm actually just called Light Swarm. P Clone is Particle Clone, and Prick is called Random Surface Points. And we'll be using these a little bit later. But let's just add those now to get that out of the way. And just go in, configure list, and save the old list. By the way, one other thing you can do up here is you can configure your keys, which means if there's a macro that you like quite a bit, for instance, Julian, let's say you decide you want to use that often, just go here under the F10 key, click on the far right button there, then choose the Julian macro, or whatever one you want. It doesn't even have to be part of your list. Now you'll see that the F10 key is Julian assigned to it. So now whenever I want to run Julian, I just hit the F10 key. Pretty darn simple. Okay, from here, let's continue on. And let me clear out what we've got here. I'm going to use the Z keyboard shortcut to get rid of this. Z's delete. And let's just start by loading the Porsche object. And the first problem that we want to solve here, and notice the Porsche object is fairly big, it takes a little while to load. The first actual problem we want to solve here is, hit the A key to fill this in, is that sometimes you have big objects. And when you're trying to set up a scene with an object like this, particularly if you've got a bunch of objects like this, it becomes very cumbersome. So one option is to use a stand-in object. And you can make a stand-in by using a macro called bounding box up at the very top. What bounding box does, and you just select it, hit OK here, and it actually tells you what to do. It says undo to remove original object. Is you run bounding box, and it creates a six-sided box that is exactly the same size as the perimeters of the object. So notice we now have a box here that exactly meshes with the object sides. Then you hit the undo button, leaving you with just the box. And here's your stand-in. What you do is you would save this object as Porsche stand-in. I would quit the program. And now what I could do is I'll just clear out this scene. I could load up the stand-in object and just use this in the interim, just use this in the meantime, until I get the scene set up. So I get this running. Anything I can do with the regular Porsche, I could do with this. Let me actually turn it around. Well, actually, this will be fine like this. Start it here at 0, then up here at 30, and then at 15, we'll just have it back here a little bit. Let's also just go to the motion graph real quickly and give it an aligned to path. And you'll notice that since this object is just a bounding box, previews and everything else render extremely quickly. And I can get a good idea of what the motion is going to be like. Then when I want to actually use the object, go to the objects menu, hit replace, then just select the original one, and it's going to replace the actual Porsche right there. And so again, you'll see making a preview takes a little bit more time here, but we don't really need to now. We test it with the stand-in. So this is one way to use that bounding box macro. It's pretty handy. Now, let's start to use a couple of the other macros that we've worked with here. And first one I want to work with is point distributions. And this is going to actually lead us into a number of other macros. What point distributions does is it randomly creates a bunch of points, as many as you select up here at the top. And it distributes those points either in a round shape, a square shape. You can change fall-off settings, but I'm just going to leave it at the default settings, a radius of 1 by 1 by 1 meter. And I'll have it generate 50 points. Hit OK. And it's just going through here, making them. There we go. Hit OK. And here's just a bunch of points. So what are we going to do with a bunch of points? Well, a number of things, actually. This will actually create particle systems. These single point objects are particles. And they're used as stars, for instance. They're also used for sparks coming off of fire. There's a lot of stuff you can do with particle things, but a lot of people are hesitant to get into it because they hear you have to do a lot of heavy programming and stuff like that. I want to show you a couple of real simple things you can do with particles just to get you started and show you how these macros function. The first thing I'm going to do is we've done a point distribution, but these won't be visible because they're just points right now. Now, if we want to make these points visible, there's another macro called points to polys. And what points to polys does, and you can assign any surface name you want, is it will go through and make each point a single point polygon or a visible particle. This way you will just see the point, and I will name this stars, or I can name it anything here. I'll name it stars. This is just a surface name. Now I will save this object as particles, quit out, clear out our scene here. Load up the particles object. And now when I do a render, what you'll see is this renders up. I'm just hitting the F9 key to render. Here's the way these load up. Visible single point particles. Now they're right in the middle of the screen. One thing you might want to do is take the whole box and move it a little bit closer to the camera. And in fact, if you wanted to, you could actually animate this so the whole thing moves towards you. Could create a whole long row of these and have it move towards you. And what you're going to get is, let me just show you this real quickly here, is here at 0, then at 30, we will have it have moved forward some. Let me make a preview here. You see the little points kind of moving towards you. You end up with the sort of science fiction effect of stars moving towards you. And because particles are just single points, they never get any bigger. If you can move them right up to the camera, they never change inside. Now, this is one use for them. Let me show you something that's so easy and yet easy and kind of impressive looking that I can't pass up showing it to you. It's a way to take a bunch of particles and get them to animate individually. So each point is moving around. And the example we're going to show you here is a way to do bugs, for instance. If you want to make these look like particles, like a swarm of mosquitoes, we can do it. But as you'll see, we could also do the same thing with sparks or anything we want. And this is, again, just ridiculously easy. what we do is we take the bunch of points here. Let me just move it at zero so they're just back out here. And so I've set it, I got rid of the keyframe at 30. And right now if we make a preview, it's just the points sitting there. They're not doing anything. All right. So let's go up and make this a 90 frame scene. And the idea here is we're going to use a function displacement mapping. And we actually have a tape where we discussed displacement mapping. Just a quick refresher or reminder or introduction to displacement mapping, depending upon where you are. Displacement mapping actually moves polygons around. It's like bump mapping, but it actually moves polygons. And you can use it to get a flag waving or water rippling, anything like that. Well, we're going to actually use displacement mapping on these points. What you do is, we got the object called particles. Go to the objects menu. Make sure you've got that chosen. And let me just warn you now, this goes real quickly, so pay attention. There's no trick here. Here's what we do. You hit displacement mapping. Choose ripples. We're pretty much done. By selecting ripples now, it's going to ripple these points around, and they're going to move almost like flies buzzing around. Now, the only thing we might want to change, and the only thing I would change here, is that the wave speed is too high. Instead of 0.025, I'll make it 0.002. Hit Use Texture. And now let's just make a preview. And while it's making the preview, just remember, the way this is going to work is it's actually moving the points around in this pattern. So when we watch the preview, you'll see that these things look like they're actually animating. And if you pick one and watch it, it kind of looks like it's moving around like a bug, and the whole thing moves around that way. Now, if we were to actually change the wave speed on this, go up to Objects, Displacement Map, let's say 0.02, which is about where it was before, all you'll see is that these are now angry bugs. They're just moving around much quicker. And this could be used to do, for instance, the look of snow being shaken up in one of those little attractive glass tourist-like things where you shake it up, snow flies, or sparks coming off of something. There's a lot of different uses for this, but again, we're just using displacement map with this, and it's a real quick, easy trick here. Okay, now we got a couple other uses for the points here, so let's go back into Modeler, and we're going to see another macro that's kind of neat here, which is called Light Swarm. Cleared out the particles that we had. Let's just generate point distributions one more time. And I'm only going to generate 15 points this time. And again, it does scatter them out in this random order. And what I'm going to do now is we're going to come back to this. We'll hold on to this for a second. I'm going to run a macro called Light Swarm. And let me just give you an example of how you would use it in a sort of normal setting. We will save this. We'll come back and apply Light Swarm to it in just a minute. But let's go to another layer here. And I'm just going to make a simple UFO object, and boy, I mean simple. It's just a disk. There's my UFO. Okay. Again, the object here is kind of irrelevant. Pretend this is the best looking UFO you've ever seen. The idea is, let's say I want this UFO to have a ring of, for instance, lights around the bottom of it. Well, what we do is, otherwise we'd have to go and load the UFO up, position the lights by hand, and it would be no fun at all. Instead, what we do is we can go in and select where we want these lights to be on a point-by-point basis. So I want lights to be here, 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 and down here. And you notice it selected the top and bottom points. I'm going to use the lasso, the right mouse button, to deselect the top here. So we just have 6 points selected along the bottom. Okay. That's it. Any questions there? Pretty straightforward. Now, all we do is we run the Light Swarm macro. And there's a little tricky part to this macro because it's actually two functions. One that you do here in Modeler, another one that you do in Lightwave. Run Light Swarm. And what it's doing is it's coming up and giving you the requester that's asking you to save a scene. And you have to give this a name. And I'll call this UFO. And then it's coming up and it's giving you a bunch of light attributes. Now this panel here are attributes for the lights that the Light Swarm macro creates. And you can go and set these attributes up any way you want to. So I will make these point lights. I will make them 50% intense. I will make them red. Now, these colors here are RGB in order. No fall off. I'll leave that alone, by the way. RGB. So if I go to R255, green 0, blue 0, I'll make them lens flare lights with a 25% lens flare intensity. Shadow casting would mean that these lights cast shadows. Outer glow lights will actually create a second light at every point. I'm going to turn that off. It's a neat effect sometimes, but I don't want that neat effect right now. Hit OK. There it is. It's done. And what it's done is it's created a scene file in the RAM disk, that's where it goes by default, called UFO. Now let's save our UFO object here. Exit out to Lightwave. Clear out everything we got here just so we're starting from scratch. Load up the old UFO object. And now under Object Still, do a load from scene. Go to your RAM disk. Just type in the word RAM colon. Again, if you haven't changed your Lightwave config file, you probably still have a RAM disk button there, but this is the only time I ever use the RAM disk in Modeler, so unless you get really addicted to LightSwarm, don't use it. You notice there's UFO. Double-click on it to load it up. And it says load lights from scene as well as objects. You definitely want to hit yes there. This is the whole point. We're loading lights. There's no point if you don't load lights. So hit yes. And then in 3.1, it's going to come up with a little error message telling you that it can't find a null object. Do you wish to select an alternative object? And the problem is it's looking for an object called null object, but the 3.1 software deletes the object called null object. But if we tell it not to select an alternate object, if we hit no here, what it's going to do is, this is what happened in any scene. If you tell it don't select an alternate object, it replaces the object with a null object. Therefore, just say no. That's the sort of moral of this story. When this comes up and says can't find null object, select an alternate object, just hit no, and it will replace the null object with a null object. And that's what it does. So now we have two objects. We have one object in the scene, the null object and the UFO here, both of these. And what you'll see is, here's our UFO. And under options, I'm going to go to show lights. I'm going to go to the top view. And there are the lights positioned exactly where we wanted on the UFO. Now, if we move the UFO, of course the lights, well, they don't do anything. They're just staying there. And all we have to do here, if we want the lights to move with the UFO, is parent the lights to the UFO. And the way we do that is each light is parented to the null object. So we pick the null object, parent it to UFO, and now wherever we move the UFO, the lights follow. And again, this is very, very handy. So we just move this out here. What you'll see is it's not a spectacular job of object modeling or anything like that. But when we hit the render button, we will have the lights in exactly the positions, and there will be red lights in those six positions. So this is a very, very handy way to quickly put lights anywhere you want on an object. You just select the points, then run the LightSwarm macro. All right, now let's go back and use the LightSwarm macro with the original object we created. What LightSwarm is going to do is it's going to give us lights at each of these 15 random points that have been created. So I'm just going to run LightSwarm here, and I'll just create this as lights. Go ahead and set our light attributes. I'm going to give these lights no intensity whatsoever, but I do want them to have a lens flare. Let's say it really doesn't make any difference, by the way, for the purposes we're going to do. 30% doesn't matter. And then turn off outer glow light, because again, now you can experiment with this on your own, but what outer glow light would do is it would add two lens flares at every point, one with just glow attributes, the other with the light attributes. It can look nice, but not for what I want to do here. So we hit OK. There. Now we will clear out here, clear out the scene completely, and there was no object. You notice I did not save the 15 points. All I was trying to do was throw points up at random and then attach lights to them, because this has actually allows you to do some neat special effects, for instance, fireworks. There's a quick way you could do that. Or little light explosions, stuff like that. And this is very, very handy for logos. Go to Objects, Load from Scene. I'm already at my RAM disk. I load up lights. Remember, load lights, yes. and just say no. What this will give us, if we go to show lights, is it brings in 15 different lights, all parented to the null object. So let's pick the null object, move it out here in the distance, and let's actually take this, let's just keyframe it there. I just want to get rid of that first light. You notice we've got the first light here that's just the distant. We don't really need that. I'll clear it out. Okay. So we've got all these lights thrown off at random. Now, one thing we could do is kind of quickly go in and take each light and change its color a little bit. And again, just use the sliders in here to kind of go and randomly throw in colors. And I'm only going to do this for a couple of them, but you get the idea. I could just go through here. And what I'm doing is I'm using the down arrow key to move to the next light, then hitting light color, changing lights the way I want them to do different color values. So I've done a few of them here. Now, what can we do with these? Well, one kind of neat thing you can do with them happens when you resize the null object. Now, these lights are all parented to the null. And what this means is if I resize, so I go to the size attribute, the null, as we size it bigger, the lights move away from that point. So we size it smaller, they move towards it until when the size is 000, all the lights are in exactly the same place. So let me size it numerically to 000, move it down here, and create a keyframe at frame 0. Then at frame 30, let's say, I will create a keyframe up here and have them be exploded. That's fairly exploded. Let me have them completely exploded. So none of the lights are visible at frame 30. Then at, let's say, frame 20, I will have it be moved up this way. And let's just make a quick preview of this. And what you'll see is the lights start blowing up immediately, which is not as effective as it could be. So one idea is to, at frame 20, or maybe a little before that, and I'm just doing a short little example here, but let's say at frame 15, have them be at this same position on the move, but have them be sized to 0. Create a keyframe there. So now from frame 0 to 15, they're going to stay the same size, then they will suddenly explode at frame 15 through 30. Now, one problem we're going to have here if we make this preview is you're going to see the lights get bigger, then get smaller, then get really bigger. We don't want that. So the problem is, one we've talked about in some of the basic tapes, but just to set it up here, is we've got a problem we need to put on linear on the second keyframe. It's a spline problem. And by putting linear on, now you'll see, stays small, and explodes. And I might want to do things a little differently, like at 30, it could probably be dropped down a little bit more. But you see the basic idea here. It goes up, explodes, and drops down. Now, if we were to take a quick render of any one of these frames, let's just go somewhere in the middle where we can still see some of the lights. This looks like a fun frame. This will take a little bit of time, so I'm going to go to super low res, and even then it'll take time. We'll just cut to the final frame here. What you're going to see is we have all these lens flares coming off. Well, one thing we could do is envelope them, so there's no light at the beginning, or a very, very dim light. And then when they hit the point where they start to explode, they envelope up, so the flare intensity increases, then goes down very, very quickly. And that's the kind of thing we can do very easily. Here's the way it looks super low res. We actually see the lights pulled away from that point. The way we would do that is just go in, and I'm going to do this for two lights, but you could just repeat it for all of them. I go in to the flare options for one light. For flare intensity, create an envelope. And I'm going to use the mouse function create here, where I want to start, well, let's just drag this down to 0 first. So I went to mouse function drag. I want to start at 0. Then at frame 15, roughly, it should still be 0. Then it should kind of quickly go up and then fade back down by that point. And I'm just going to go in. I was a little off on some of these, so I just go in and I can drag them. So it should be back off again by 30, let's say. And that's probably a little high. By the way, if you're doing a whole bunch of lights, you don't want the flare intensity to go too high. It goes insane. Here we have the same problem we did before. We have to do two keyframes in the same position. You need to put on linear. There we go. Now, once this is created for one light, I just save this envelope. Light. Then go to the next light, flare options, intensity, load envelope, use envelope. Next one, same thing. And you see the idea here. I can kind of quickly go through and give all these lights the same envelope. So just another example of the way you could use LightSwarm. And again, we just set this up in just a few seconds there, but it's the kind of thing you could set up and get a fairly decent look. I've also used LightSwarm, for instance, to put lights around the sides of letters. So letters actually, and then give the lights themselves sort of an envelope there. So the letters look as though they're flickering on and off, like they're lit up by fireworks or something like that. A lot of ways you can play with this macro, but again, a lot of people don't know it's there. And if they do know it's there, they don't know how it works. Okay, finally, I want to show you how we use those particle clone and random point distribution macros. Another handy little thing here. And let me just set up a problem. And I'm going to start this time by rendering a landscape. And quickly, we can model a landscape here. I'll pull us back out so our grid size is fairly big. I'm dragging out a flat polygon. And I want to make it multi-segmented. So I'll give it, let's say, 25 segments by 25 segments. Right? And I notice that the polygons are facing the wrong way, because whenever I draw out a flat polygon in the top view, they always face downward. So I deselect everything, hit the F key. F is the keyboard shortcut for the flip function. It just flips all the polygons so they're now facing upward. And then I'm going to use the magnet tool just to kind of go in and quickly draw out some mountains. And the magnet tool, just as a refresher, the magnet tool, the left mouse button selects basically how big an area we're affecting. The right mouse button drags you up or down. And we'll just go out and drag a little something up in the background. So we've created this little landscape. And let's just make it, right now it's okay, but it's probably a little flat. I mean, it's going up and down, but the individual polygons are still very, very normal. One quick way around that is the jitter function. What jitter does, and keyboard shortcut is Shift-J, or you can find it in the Tools menu under Jitter. But Shift-J, it just will randomly throw around points, therefore moving the polygons, and the maximum radius is whatever you set here. So I don't want it to be too big. I guess 0.5, 0.5, 0.5. And if I zoom in here a little bit, you see, it just kind of randomly throws these around. And this will give our landscape a little bit more of a rough look. Okay, so far so good. Now let's say I want to get fancy with our landscape here. And I want to put trees on it. Have fun. The problem you're going to have, of course, is that putting trees on here, positioning them, very, very hard to do in wireframe. So it's going to be no fun at all. And that's where random surface points and particle clone come in handy. These two macros allow you to add objects, and in this case to a landscape, but really to anything. This is a perfect example for it. Let me take you through, show you how you'd use it. All right, so we select random surface points. This is the way you run it. You select random surface points. Then it says approximate number of points, and believe me, this is pretty approximate. There's a complex way this goes through and works. It's going to basically end up sort of, it's trying to lay it across, and it takes the square root of the number and all kinds of brainiac stuff. What dumb people like me remember is that whatever number you give it, it's going to give you less number of points. So if I give it, for instance, let's say 100 points, it's going to say how many it drew. And if I give it 100 over here, let's just see, it actually drew 32 of them. Okay, that works for me. So the idea is now we have 32 points, and you will see that they are put right along the surface of the object. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to generate a tree here, and then we are going to use particle clone to put the tree at these random points. So let's go to another layer, and rather than generating a tree, I'm going to do the smart lazy thing, go to the landscape directory, and I will just load up the coconut tree object that comes with the toaster. And let me just hold down the shift key in the background and select layer one. I just want to see how the coconut tree compares to the, this is okay. The coconut tree is probably a little big compared to the landscape. It's just the landscape that I created was small compared to the real world. So let's actually go in here and resize the tree down. It'll work a little bit better. And yeah, that works a little bit better. And then let's just take a look at the tree. And I want the tree so it's basically the bottom of the tree is at the zero point, right like this. But I want the tree centered in other ways. And the quick way to do this is a macro center 1D. This lets you center it in any one dimension. In this case, I want to center it on the x-axis and the z-axis. By the way, the keyboard shortcut for center 1D, unless you've changed your config keys, is the F2 key. So I'll pick Z. There we go. It's nice and centered. Now what I do is I take the layer that's got the random surface points that were created, and I put that in the background. So there they are. Then I run particle clone. Just select particle clone, release. And what it's doing is it's making clones of the trees every place there was a point there in the background. And again, the coconut tree here is a fairly large, substantial object. But what we'll see here in just a couple seconds is something that looks like this. So here are our trees, and if we were to view the ground plane, let's actually hold down shift and click on the first layer, the top, to select that in addition. What you'll see is the trees are going up, going into the valley down here, fitting perfectly. Now they don't rotate or anything like that, it just lays down the trees straight up. But this is sure a darn sight easier. We could go in now and rotate them individually if we want to. But it's obviously a lot better than trying to position these things by hand. That would, again, just, it would kill you. You'd never want to do it. So that's the way these macros work, and they're quite handy. Let me give you one other possibility here. Rather than doing trees, let's say you wanted to do the high up in a hill looking down into the lights of the valley sort of thing. What could you do? Well, we've already seen it. You could create random surface points. Then use the light swarm macro, and light swarm would throw a light at every random surface point. Then as you look at this ground plane, you would see lights along the ground there. Now, there's obviously, we've scratched the surface of some of this stuff, and the point is, go through, look for the macros that are there, and in fact, now that you've kind of seen some of the secret world of the toaster by using show all files and a number of the other settings here, you can go through and actually experiment. Try some of the macros. Try some of the toaster paint macros in AREX. Try writing your own keyboard shortcuts. Or just nose around a little bit. It's hard to hurt stuff, although it's possible. So before you start editing files heavily or anything like that, you'd probably do yourself pretty well to copy, make a backup copy of it as we've discussed. Also, don't go around and deleting things at random. Not generally a good idea. Remember, you're on your own. I'm a trained professional. Don't try some of this stuff at home unless you've taken adequate safety measures for your computer. That's all for this tape. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate to write to us at the address you see on your screen right now. Until next time, my name is Lee Stranahan. Thanks a lot. Bye.